Hey everybody, Dave Isaacs here with you from the guitar studio on Music Row here in Nashville, Tennessee. And I want to do a quick lesson on a very popular country song called Tennessee Whiskey by Chris Stapleton. And the great thing about this song is that it's two chords, it's a simple strum. As long as you can manage a basic B minor barre chord, then you can play it almost exactly as it's played. And you can also use a simpler capo position to avoid the barre chord and play it with simply a G and an A minor. It's also got a great electric guitar intro that you can play with one finger, which is really, really cool. Let's take a look. The song is in six. One, two, three, four, five, 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 six. Now you notice that you could say it's in three. You could count waltz time. Two, three, one, two, three, one, two. And you wouldn't be wrong, but when it comes to popular music in general, generally if we have a three count, it's more six than it is a waltz, in the sense that 6-8 is really a slow back and forth between two beats, which are split into three. One, two, three, four, five, six. One, two, three, four, five, six. If you listen to the song and to the backing track that you're going to hear in a little bit, you'll notice that the drums do this. One, two, three, four, five, six, kick, two, three, snare, five, six. So that's dividing up the beat into a six count rather than two three counts. It's kind of a semantic thing, but it does feel a little different to approach a song in 6-8 than it does in 3-4, so just be aware of that. The basic strum is on an A chord, and I'm just playing every strong beat for the most part, and then a B minor, to the A. So what I'm strumming is simply 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Now the thing is, you can fill it in 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 5, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I'm doing this two ways. Well, okay, three ways. One is to strike either the bass note of the chord or simply the bass area of the chord. So in the case of the A, that might mean the fifth string alone or the fifth and fourth strings or something in this neighborhood. But the idea is to differentiate this sound from this sound. And notice how I'm using that. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So the first thing is simply hitting the bass note, and generally I'm feeling it on count 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And then I also just demonstrated hitting the 8th notes, 4, 5, 6. As a little bit of punctuation to kind of move us forward, like this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Now you might sometimes split those two things and hit 4, 5 as a chord and the bass note as 6, like this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 6. Which works real well. It's a nice combination. 4, 5, 6, 1, 2. And then we add this. Also very common in songs in 6. It's a further subdivision of the beat. Dee-da-da, dee-da-da-da. By the way, there was a little left-hand figure I need to address there, but I'm going to come back to that. We're not just in a straight six. We're actually swinging this a little bit. So it's not 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, which would sound like this. Bum-tika-ducka-dum-tika-ducka-dum. is not the right feel. The song's got kind of a soul feel to it. And that's coming from the fact that the subdivisions are swung. Let me show you what I mean. Instead of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, notice how I'm dividing 2, 3, and 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Here's the basic beat. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Split in threes. 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And then we can divide each of those. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. That's a straight feel, but what this song does is this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Strumming wise, that gives us something like this if I played every one of those beats. Which of course doesn't feel right. So we use a little bit of that. It just adds a little bit of rhythmic drive. It kind of propels us into the next bar. So listen to the way these three approaches combine in terms of the right-hand strum. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. When I do have that faster 16th note strum, notice that I'm doing it one of two different ways. Like this. Down, down, up, down. Or as down, up, down. Now all of these things are going to be combined in different ways. If you look at the basic elements, you can start with a simple strum. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4. Then start adding in more bass notes. Notice how that single bass note seems to fall naturally on count 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And now I can add. Now, this one other figure that I'm playing at the end of the chord sequence is a little embellishment to the A chord, which really could be left out. It's not essential to the song, but it's a nice touch. I'm playing the A chord as a bar, using my index finger flattened out with the tip segment bent back a little bit so I can cover strings 4, 3, and 2 comfortably. All three of those notes are ringing. I'm not worrying about the high E string so much. Some of you may find that when you do this, you can get that high E string to ring. If I really concentrate on it, I'll hear it. But it's not essential to the sound. The idea is that we want to hear this. So the fifth string bass, and then that index finger bar covering 4, 3, 2. Then I'm playing a D chord, really, but it's used as an embellishment to the A. I'm adding my ring finger on the fourth string, fourth fret, my middle finger on the second string, third fret, and we get this nice D form, which works beautifully with that barred A. And you've heard this 1,000 times in 1,000 songs. It's a very useful thing to know how to do. If you're not comfortable with the bar, it's going to take some time to put that together. Like I said, you can play the song without that. You can just play a straight A chord. But this is such a nice figure, and it's used to kind of punctuate the sequence. It only happens at the end of the entire chord cycle. So I'm going to put it all together now. So this is just the intro. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. You notice that little figure at the end with that D form. like this. And the thing is, the song is really just those chords over and over again. You can plug in the 16th note strums, the up-down strums. You can plug in that D-A figure, that little embellishment, pretty much anywhere. But the entire song is that chord sequence all the way through. It makes it a great introduction to this 6-8 rhythm. It's really simple to play. It's a great song. And I want to show you as well, if the bar chords are challenging, you can put a capo on the 2nd fret, which of course transposes us, right? Whenever you put a capo on, you have moved whatever chord shape you're fingering up whatever number of half steps corresponds to the fret you're on. So if the capo is on the 2nd fret, I've moved up 2 half steps. That means that to play an A, what I really want to do is play what looks like a G, and the sound that comes out is an A. It's going to sound as an A chord. And when you're playing a song, it's much better to just think of it as the 1 chord or the home chord than to think of it as I'm playing G, but it's really an A. That happens to be true, but it's mentally confusing. So we're starting from a G. We can use the same basic rhythm and use an A minor instead of the B minor. I referred to 1, a number, a moment ago for the G chord. If we're in the key of A, A is the first note of the scale, A is the 1 chord, the chord of note 1. That makes B minor the 2 minor chord, the chord of note 2. So if we go to G, if G is 1, that makes A note 2, and so A minor is the chord of note 2. Now keep in mind, we haven't actually changed the chords. We've just changed the fingerings that we're using because of the capo. And this is a way to sidestep the bar chord if the bar chord is a challenge. Now, I'm going to, of course, advocate for if you can't play bar chords, for working on that so you get to the point where you can. The shortcut is useful in learning the single song, but know that going forward as a guitar player, you really want to be able to manage bar chords. But let me just illustrate how this would work with the G fingering capo on the 2nd fret. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1 thing I will say for the capo fingering, notice that I'm playing the G this way. So I'm using pinky on the 1st string, ring extended on the 6th, and middle over here on the 2nd fret of the 5th string. That middle finger note is not actually essential. You can allow the ring finger to block that A string if you want. And I love this fingering for a G chord because it's nice and clean and clear sounding. But it also leaves the index and middle fingers free. So when you have a lick like this, they're right here already. What I'm playing is essentially a piece of a C chord. So in this case, I'm taking the G, and my index and middle fingers are going to 2nd string for the index, and 4th string for the middle. We get what would be written as C/G, because this is basically a C chord with a G bass and a double high note up top. Now again, got the capo on, so the notes that I'm referring to, the letters I'm using, reflect the fingering, not the actual sound. We are transposing. But in how you think of it, you're probably gonna end up thinking G chord, and the bottom line is, when you don't have a capo, that's what this chord is. So that's what you wanna think of it as, just recognize that as you use the capo, you're moving the sound up. So we have this nice, which is a little easier than working off the bar in the open position. So basically, that's the song. Very, very simple. Now, if you look at the link in the description, there's a backing track that you can play along to practice this. So work with that, see how that feels, and then continue on for part 2, and we'll look at this intro on the electric guitar that you can play with 1 finger. It's very, very cool. So when you get this, come on back for part 2, and we'll keep going. Thanks for watching.